فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that a man came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, I am ruined, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, what has ruined you? The man replied, I had intercourse with my wife during the day in Ramadan while fasting. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, are you able to free a slave? The man said, no. The Prophet said, can you fast for 2 consecutive months? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then asked him, can you provide food for 60 poor people? He said, no. Then the man sat down. A basket of dates was brought to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said to the man, give this as sadaqah. The man said, to someone who is poorer than us? There is no one in this city who is in need of these dates more than us. The Prophet laughed until his molar teeth could be seen and said to the man, go and feed your family with these dates.
An Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, an Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, annahu atahu rajulun, faqala ya Rasulullah, halaktu. Qala wa ma ahlakak. Qal waqa'tu ala imra'ati fi Ramadan. قال هل تستطيع أن تعتق رقبة؟ قال لا. قال هل تستطيع أن تصوم شهرين متتابعين؟ قال لا. قال هل تستطيع أن تطعم 60 مسكينا؟ قال لا. قال فاجلس. فجلس فأتي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بعرق فيه تمر. قال فتصدق به. قال ما بين لا بيتها أحد أفرق منا أفقر منا. قال فضحك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى بدت أنيابه. قال خذه فأطعمه أهلك. متفق عليه.
This hadith shows us what is the ruling al-jima' to have intimacy with your wife fi nahari Ramadan, in the day in Ramadan time, having sexual relation with your wife basically whilst you're fasting. What is the ruling? This hadith that you've just heard is an evidence that is severe, and it's a severe sin and is dangerous fi jima'i to have intimacy fi nahari Ramadan whilst you're fasting. Because when the man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did the man say? He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, halaktu, I've destroyed. The Prophet went quiet and he didn't say, no, you're not destroyed. Sah? And that's called iqrar. The Prophet done taqreer for him. He agreed with him on that. So why would the Prophet agree with him? Unless it's a what? It's a severe sin. So the Prophet agreed with him and he agreed with him and he went quiet because of that. And he said to him, وَمَا أَهْلَكَكَ, what is it that destroyed you? The man responded, he said to the Prophet, I basically fell into a sin. That which has been made haram from me. Are you with me? And Aisha's hadith in Sahih Muslim is a different wording. He said, احترقت, I'm burnt. You mean I'm going to be burnt in the hellfire, he means. So the person who has intimacy and relationship with his wife, whilst he's fasting, his fast is null and void. يَبْطُلُ صَوْمَهُ. His fasting becomes destroyed, so he's not fasting that day. But that's with condition, إِذَا كَالَ مُعْتَمِدًا. Sorry, if it is مُتَعَمِّدًا, if it's deliberately. If the person does it deliberately, and he remembers that he's fasting. Based on that, according to the scholars, يَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ, and this is the call of the jumhur of the ulama, upon him is that he has to bring it back. He has to bring that fasting back, in which he has destroyed. مَعَ التَّوْبَةِ النَّصُوحَةِ, he has to come with a good repentance. And then is also upon him أَغْلَضُ الْكَفَارَاتِ, the most strongest and toughest forms of kafarat, expiations, with this great sin. And it is in this order. The first one is عتق رقبة مؤمنة, freeing the slave, the neck of a slave. If he can't find it, فإن لم يجد, if he's not able to, فَصِيَامُ شَهْرَيْنِ مُتَتَابِعَيْنِهِ fast two consecutive months. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ if he's not able to. فَإِطْعَامُ السِّتِينَ مِسْكِينًا he provides for 60. And every one of them مُدُّ بُرٍ he gives them a mud of a burr. We're going to mention what a burr and what it is. I mean, the mud is. The mud is 563 grams. 563 grams. Rice will suffice you. Or غالب قوت البلدة, the land that you're living in, the common thing that they eat. Huh? What's the most common thing that's eaten? You give the weight of that in that land. Don't give chicken curry. Yeah. What about if the person has intimacy with his wife and he forgot? Just like he forgot, you know, he forgets, he eats by accident and he forgot. What about if he has intimate relationship with his wife? Nasiyan, and he's forgotten. فَإِنَّ صَوْمَهُ صَحِحْ We mentioned last lesson. Yesterday, his fasting is correct and he carries on. And this is في أصحي قولي العلماء. This is from the strongest of the two opinions from the scholars. وَلَا So there's no qada on him. He doesn't have to bring his fasting back. وَلَا كَفَارَ And there's no expiation on him. الإمام البخاري who he brought in his Sahih from two noble scholars, Hassan al-Basri and Mujahid ibn Jabrin, that they said, إِن جَامَعَ نَاسِيًا فَلَا شَيْءَ عَلَيْهِ Are you with me, brothers? If he has relationship with his wife, if he has relationship with his wife and he forgot, then there's nothing upon him. What about if the man has relationship with his wife after Fajr, believing that it's still night, he thought it was not yet time. He got the time wrong. He knows it's Ramadan, he knows he's meant to be fasting, he got carried away, he didn't know. Fajr came in. صح? Then it became clear to him what went wrong. فَلَا قَضَى عَلَيْهِ وَلَا كَفَارَةٌ There's no expiation upon him and he doesn't have to bring that back. This is what عَلَى الرَّاجِحِ مِنْ قَوْلِ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ From the strongest of the opinions of the scholars and the people of knowledge. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentions that in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, the 25th volume. And he says this, وَهَذَا الْقَوْلُ أَصَحُّ الْأَقْوَالِ وَأَشْبَهُهَا بِأُصُولِ الشَّرِيعَةِ وَدَلَالَةُ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ وَهُوَ قِيَاسُ أُصُولِ أَحْمَدِ وَغَيْرُهُ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ رَفَعَ الْمُؤَاخَذَةُ عَلِ النَّاسِ وَالْمُخْطِئِ He says, this is what's in accordance to the Kitab and the Sunnah and the principles of the Sharia, which is what? رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا And we said in Sahih Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? قَدْ فَعَلْتُ I did it. قَدْ فَعَلْتُ That was all the ruling for the man. That was the ruling for the man. What about the woman? As for the woman, فَإِنَّ صَوْمَهَا يَفْسُدْ Her fasting becomes corrupt. وَعَلَيْهَا الْقَضَاء And she has to bring it back مُطْلَقًا unrestrictedly. As for the expiation, فَإِنْ كَانَتْ مُطَاوِعَةً لِزَوْجَتِهَا فَإِنْ كَانَتْ مُطَاوِعَةً لَزِمَتْهَا If she was in obedience with him, the woman in all those circumstances, she has to bring back the fasting. They say exception. We're going to mention this issue. If the woman... No, I'm talking about the last one. In the last situation. After Fajr, if they do it. Huh? The woman, after Fajr, if she does it. She has to bring it back. But there's only qada, she has to just bring it back. Kafara is not on her. Are you with me, brothers? Other scholars like Ibn Sikit and others, they mention that every situation a woman has to bring it back. They say that. But if she did it and she found out it was wrong, she has to bring it back. Are you with me? Does that make sense? Because generally speaking, the women already have it easy for in terms of the ruling of the fasting being lifted from them in the month of Ramadan, the days that she doesn't have to fast. So bringing it back is made on her. Whereas the man, 30 days is going to have to fast. There's no way out of it. That's what they say. But that qiyas. It's an analogy. But her situation is one. If they say if she did it, If she did it, she has to bring it back. If she did it in obedience to her husband, are you with me? So one is for her own self. Are you there? Pay attention to this. The woman, she has intimacy with her husband. If she has it because she wants it, that's it. If she does it because of him, is another ruling. If she does it because she wants it, only qada is upon her. If she does it in obedience to him, qada and kafara is both upon her. Naam.
Aisha radiallahu anhu and Umm Salma radiallahu anhu reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would wake during Ramadan in a state of major impurity without a wet dream. But on account of sexual intercourse, he would take a bath before dawn and fast. And in the narration of Umm Salma, she said he wouldn't pay it back.
عن عائشة وأم سلمة رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يصبح جنبا من جماع ثم يغتسل ويصوم متفق عليه وفي حديث أم سلمة ولا يقضي.
This hadith tells us صحة صوم من أصبح جنبا. The person who is fasting, but he wakes up from an intimate relationship that he had at night, last night, but he's still in the state of janabah. He hasn't still done the ghusl. Pay attention. The intimate relationship was done long time ago. It was what? The night, when it was permissible. But he still hasn't had janabah. He hasn't purified himself yet. If that's the case, Aisha and Umm Salama both said that the Prophet ﷺ كان يصبح جنوبا. He would wake up actually in a state of janabah. من جماع, from intimacy. ثم يغتسل, and then he would do his غسل ويصوم, and he would fast. He would do that عليه الصلاة والسلام. Are you there, brothers? So the Fajr adhan will go off whilst he's in a state of janabah. Are you with me, brothers? وفي حديث أم سلمة ولا يقضي, and he didn't what? And he would never bring that fasting back. There's no قضاء. Are you with me, brothers? Jinabah is anything that necessitates, whenever something comes out of you, that necessitates intimacy, that necessitates ghusl. It's anything in which you have to do ghusl, whether you release, or whether iltiqa, the meeting of the two genitals. Even if nothing comes out, it doesn't matter. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا الْتَقَى الْخِتَانَانِ وَجَبَ الْغُسْلُ. إِذَا الْتَقَى الْخِتَانَانِ, if the two, and from this the scholars they took that the woman has to be circumcised. They said from this hadith, إِذَا الْتَقَى الْخِتَانَانِ, if the two circumcision, وَجَبَ الْغُسْلُ, the ghusl is obligatory. صح؟ وَجَبَ الْغُسْلُ, the ghusl is what? It's obligatory, even if they just touch. There doesn't have to be any, what do you call it, any release or anything. It doesn't have to be. Just the fact that they touch, there's ghusl wajib. Allah says in the Quran, فَالْآنَ بَاشِرُوهُنَّ وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَكُلُوا وَشَرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. Here's an issue that we want to talk about, which is the woman who's on her menstruation. So we've learned that if the person is on a state of janabah and the fajr comes in, are you with me, brothers? Can they fast? Of course they can fast. And they carry on their fasting. based on the hadith that we just took right now. And there's another hadith, Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking him a question. He said, Ya Rasulullah, tudrikuni salat, the salah comes to me, Fajr, wa ana junubun, and I'm in a state of janaba. Afa asumu, can I fast that day? Then the man said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wa ana, even me, tudrikuni salat, same thing happens to me, the salah comes on me, wa ana junubun, and I'm in a state of janaba, fa asumu, and I fast for it. Then the man said to the Prophet, falasta mithlana, Ya Rasulullah, you're not like us. You're not like us. فَقَدْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَرَ. Allah has forgiven you for your past and for your upcoming sins. You might be, this might be an exception for you. You can do this maybe. But for us, we're not allowed to do that. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَرْجُو أَنْ أَكُونَ أَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ. I hope to be from the ones who fear Allah the most from amongst you. وَأَعْلَمُكُمْ. And I am the most knowledgeable from amongst you. بِمَا أَتْقَى, that which I need to fear Allah on. So I know, the Prophet saying, that if this something was wrong, I would have known it. And I would have told you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what we learned is this, that if a person is in a state of janaba, we get it. We now know, male or female, صح? There's another issue that's connected here, which is the woman who's on her menstruation, or she's on her postnatal bleeding. Nifas is a postnatal bleeding, is when the woman gives birth, she has 40 days, where she's on a nifas. What's the situation from her? Let's say she sees that she's pure after Fajr. Sorry, before Fajr, قبل الفجر. Before Fajr, the sister realizes that she's on a dahara, that her menstruation has stopped, and there's ways that a woman can know. صح? She realizes it's stopped, it's over now. She then fasts, because it's before, she fasts with the people. Even if Fajr comes and she still hasn't cleaned herself, she takes a ruling of the janaba, right? Because when did the tahara stop? So when the menstruation stopped and when the postnatal bleeding stopped, it was before Fajr. Just like the other person had intimacy before Fajr. And it got dragged on through to after Fajr came in, right? Same is to the sister who's on her menstruation and postnatal bleeding. And she has to fast. Another question, if a person has wet dream whilst he's fasting, sah? They have a wet dream whilst they're fasting. Are you with me? Your fasting is correct because you had no choice. You never brought it out of yourself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say in the Quran? La yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa wus'a. Pay attention to this. Allah does not burden you on something that's out of your reach, out of your ability. Is this a part of your ability? Is it from your wus'a? It's not from your wus'a. It's not from your wus'a. But if you take means that will lead to that, then you're in serious danger. Also, this hadith shows another thing. What is it that many people say to you? Oh, akhi, are you fasting? Akhi, you're not allowed to go. You're not allowed to have a. Have you guys? I don't know about Somali community say this. Where's the Somali kid who's sitting here? I told him sit here. It was quick. That's how they all are. All of them, one by one, they went. I saw them all go. Just him, I couldn't see. Subhanallah. You think they got jobs? The way they get up, it's like their car, the parking is getting over, and they're gonna get a ticket, a jeep. They say to the people that you can't have a shower whilst you're fasting. Have you heard that before? Oh, you guys as well? Okay. Are you Pakistani? Okay, so it's a Pakistani thing. They do as well. Do they say it to you guys, huh? That you're not allowed to fast? That you're not allowed to fast? If you have... Okay, what about you? Can you go swimming? Yeah? Have you heard that one before? Huh? You can't go swimming whilst you're fasting. Oh, I used to... I grew up. My parents used to say that to me. Not my dad, my mum. I said to them, no, you can't go swimming. No swimming, you're fasting. My water will go into you. My body's open. So, this hadith is a refutation of that. I mean, if I knew that when I was young, I would have refused to my mom on this. I said, mom, you're wrong. Yeah, it's wrong. Based on the hadith, because the Prophet ﷺ, he said, ثُمَّ يَغْتَسِلُ وَيَصُومُ. When are you doing the ghusl? After Fajr. So you're fasting, right? وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ الْبُخَارِي, that's why he chapter a bab in the Sahih. بَابُ اِغْتِسَالِ الصَّائِمِ. The chapter of the one who is fasting to have a bath. Some people actually say you can't have a you can't shower or you can't, is because they think it's a nu'min al-tabarrud, you know, it calms you down and are you with me? And you relax from it, and fasting is about endurance and whatnot. Hadith, that's extra, that's extra. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, then he starts bringing the statement of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and then he Sha'biyu and others who said that it is not a problem if a person does it. Naam.
Narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to kiss and embrace while he was fasting, but he was the one of you who had most control over his desire. And in a wording of Muslim, he would kiss in the month of Ramadan.
An Aisha radiallahu anha qalat kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam yuqabbilu wa huwa sa'imun ويباشر وهو صائم ولكنه كان أملككم لأربه رواه البخاري ومسلم وفي رواية لمسلم
لأربه
وفي رواية لمسلم كان يقبل في شهر صوم.
This hadith is talking about the issue of مباشرة, playing around with your wife, hide and seek, huh? والقبلة, and kissing your wife. لِلصَّائِمِ, when you're fasting. Are you allowed to play with your wife whilst you're fasting? This hadith, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ the Prophet يُقَبِّلُ وَهُوَ صَائِمٌ. The Prophet, he used to kiss whilst he was fasting. He would kiss. عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. وَيُبَاشِرُ, and he would also physically touch his wives and play with them like that. وَهُوَ صَائِمٌ, whilst he was fasting. وَلَكِنَّهُ but كَانَ أَبْلَكُكُمْ لِأَرَبِهِ, but the Prophet was the strongest when it came to protecting and safeguarding his private part. He knew when to hold back. عليه الصلاة والسلام. This is not then recommended for a young person who just got married, especially those who get married in Ramadan. I don't know how they do that. You get married in Ramadan. It shouldn't be right after Ramadan or before Ramadan. At least 6 months. Get used to each other. You don't want to get caught off-site. Once you get married in Ramadan, and then all day you're with kafara, qada, kafara, qada, kafara, qada, sah? Ya Zakaria, some problem. Mm-hmm. So a young person shouldn't go close to his wife. Recommended. It's not halal or haram, I'm not saying that, but wiqaya, to be protected. Because if you kiss and then you get caught off sight and you go wrong, it's a problem. Sahih? It's a problem, you don't want to do that. And the Prophet said, when he kissed his wife, if you use that as evidence, we're going to say to you, the Prophet, he was what? He was the one who can protect his private part the most. He knew where to hold back. But if you don't know where to hold back, it's a problem. وَلَكِنَّوْ كَانَ أَمْلَكُكُمْ لِأَرَابِهِ. He was the one who was able to do that. So this hadith shows us before, يَدَعُ طَعَامُهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. He leaves off his food and his drinking and his intimacy. Sorry, so the word يَدَعُ طَعَامُ وَشَرَابُ وَشَهْوَةُ. شَهْوَة means here what? Sexual intercourse. Because look, kissing is a shahwa, you're allowed that. Sleeping is a shahwa, you're allowed that. So this shahwa in this hadith is specifically referred to only intimacy that's prohibited. And the person, ikhwani, should honor Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's hudud. ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ حُرُمَاتِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ. The person should safeguard Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what he prohibited from you. Don't get close to it. If a man's playing with his wife, and whilst he's kissing her and he's playing and he's not having any intimacy or anything with her, and then madhi comes out. Madhi is the premature ejaculation. It is what comes out before the mani. Mani is what they would call the semen. His fasting is not destroyed by that. في أصح قولي العلماء, based on the strongest of the opinion of scholars, it's something that comes out from a person who is not having an intimate relationship. So one should stay away from that anyways. He should what? Stay away from it. What about if it comes, many comes out from him? Oh, many, the real one comes out now. And he's kissing his wife and he's playing with his wife and the real deal comes out. Huh? What does he do in this situation? عليه القضاء. He has to pay back. على قولي العلماء, on the strongest of the opinion of the scholars. ولا كفارة عليه, but there's no expiation. Expiation is specific to the جماع, the intimacy. Are you with me, brothers? لأنه مختص بالجماع. That's specific to the, and there is upon him repentance and a ندم, regret. You have to regret what you just did. Something serious. والاستغفار والابتعاد عن هذه الأشياء. And stay away from these issues and leave it off. نعم.
Narrated by Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, I traveled with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam during the month of Ramadan. But neither the observer of the fast found fault with the breaker of the fast, nor the breaker of the fast found fault with the observer of the fast.
عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال سافرت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في رمضان فلم يعي الصائم على المفطر ولا المفطر على الصائم متفق عليه.
This hadith talks about حكم صوم المريض والمسافر. A person is a traveler or they're sick. How? What is it regarding that in terms of fasting? This hadith shows, based on the companions, they didn't rebuke one another or scold one another or didn't belittle each other. Some were fasting whilst they were traveling and some weren't fasting. This shows us, أن المسافر مخير بين أن يصوم. You're allowed to, you have a choice. Do you want to fast? You can fast. Do you want to leave off the fasting? You can leave off the fasting. Are you with me, brothers? So if you feel like, إذا رأى أن فيه قوة, if you feel like you're strong and you're strong and you're the man, then you can fast. And you can break your fast if you feel like you're what? If you're what? If you feel like you're weak and you won't be able to, then you can break your fast and you shouldn't. And you won't do your fasting. The fact that the Prophet ﷺ saw two parties of each one taking a stance, the Prophet's iqrar, his consent, and the fact that he was quiet about it is the evidence that some of them were fasting and some of them broke their fast. And we know that iqrar and the consent of the Prophet ﷺ is a hujjah, it's a proof. And of course, there's an ayah in the Quran where Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala clearly says, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants ease for you. So this is rukhsah, it's an ease. And this also teaches us the issue of difference of opinions that are valid, that we should respect one another. If people have different opinions on matters, and this issue that they have difference of on opinion is a valid difference of opinion, then one should not scold the other. You could have a fruitful discussion, but there has to be si'at al-sadr, the hearts have to be open for it. Both parties should still love one another. Hate and love should not be based on it. We should love each other regardless. But to have a discussion about it is good. You could do so. But if the issue isn't, if the issue is not a matter which there's the difference of opinion is not valid. As the poet said, وَلَيْسَ كُلُّ خِلَافٍ جَاءَ مُعْتَبَرًا إِلَّا مَا كَانَ لَهُ حَظٌّ مِنَ النَّظَرِ. Not every difference of opinion that comes, is there a right for us to say, oh, this is, it's a valid difference of opinion. There are invalid difference of opinion, and there's also valid difference of opinion. Okay? The valid difference of opinion is the difference of opinion which both parties are extracting the same evidences, they're using the same evidences. Are you with me? But they're just taking out different rulings out of it. Just like the issue of, should you put your knees down when you're going in the prayer, or should you put your hands down? This is a valid difference of opinion. Each party are looking at the camel, and they're looking at it from a different angle. It's one of those things you have nice fruitful discussions regarding, but there's no love or hate based on it. Okay? I can express my opinion, and you can express your opinion. Sah? There are opinions like that. But there are also some opinions that the difference of opinion here is not acceptable. It's not. If somebody, for example, comes to you and says to you, Akhi, Nabid is permissible. Nabid is a form of alcohol. And brings you some of the statement of the Salaf who said it was permissible. Like ulama Kufa. He brings you their opinion and they say to you, this Nabid is permissible. I have opinion of some scholars who say, Hada laysa We have a delil where the Prophet ﷺ said, "Kullu ma askara, anything that intoxicates is alcohol, and every alcohol is haram." Right? We have a delil from the Prophet ﷺ. Are you with me, brothers? Nabid is it's when basically the water and dates are added together and they're left at a place for a very long time and it changes and then it can intoxicate the mind. Okay? It can intoxicate the mind. Are you with me? So they're saying this is made out of another substance that what the Prophet prohibited, it wasn't made out of it. Okay? It's not made out of grapes, for example. And that is what was prohibited, مثلا. Are you with me? The prohibition is specific to what the Prophet prohibited, not every fuf. Are you with me, brothers? We say, هذا الخلاف ليس معتبراً. This difference of opinion is not valid. صح? So when the person is traveling and two people are traveling, everybody should look at their own situation. Brother, you're traveling with me and I'm traveling with you. If each one sees that they are unable to fast, or that one sees that he can fast, there should not be no quarrels and arguments regarding it. Fast if you wish, I won't fast. So the one who fasts shouldn't look at the one who's not fasting. Akhi, look, I'm pious and I'm taqwa. Al-Iman, look at you, breaking your fast. Are you with me? That shouldn't be the case. So this hadith shows that it's permissibility. Na'am. Yeah, you have to bring it back. So if you break your fast, of course, anytime you break a fast, male or female, fasting is obligatory. You have to bring it back. You have to what? Bring it back. As for the person who is sick, the illness is divided into two. If the illness is a temporary illness, then what's upon you is what? Just qada. Are you with me, brothers? Qada. If it's a temporary illness, for example, that day you got a stomach ache, and you break it, then just qada, nothing else upon you. Or that Ramadan, something must have happened to you. For example, you went through a surgery, and then, you know, so that whole month you've been out. Are you with me, brothers? Then it's a temporary issue. But a person has diabetes, for example, and it seems like it's a permanent thing. They have diabetes, or they've got cancer, or they've got an illness that, you know, لا يرجى برؤه. No expectations of this person recovering from it. There's no expectations right now. That person upon them is not qada. Kafara is upon them. Kafara is upon them. And what they do is, they have to provide for 30 miskeen. 30 poor people. Now it's their choice. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as it was narrated by Abdul Razak in his Musannaf, Ibn Abi Shayba and Daraqutni, is that Anas ibn Malik, he brought them all one time, fed them, and he told them to go home. You could do that. Or what you can do is every day you can feed one in the 30 days of Ramadan. It's your choice. You can do all at one time and feed them. Or you're allowed to do what? Every single day in the 30 days, you do one. Na'am Dawood, Loka.
So the ones that you feed, do they have to be
Muslims? No, it doesn't have to be Muslims. You don't have to just feed Muslims, no. Na'am. Now they have to do within Ramadan.
In Ramadan,
Oh, you mean, what do you mean? You mean bringing back the fasting you took out, or the feeding of the masakin?
Bringing back the fasting.
You have to bring it back. There's no condition for you to have to bring it before the other one.
So you
have to
bring back at any time.
It's just a deynu Allah haqqu an yuqta. It's a debt of Allah on you, you just have to pay that debt. But then delaying it is something you need to be scared, because you're going to be asked for this. It's haqqu Allah. If your human's debt, your body, when the Prophet ﷺ, he came to a burial and they told him, Ya Rasulullah, there's a man in his grave. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, is there debt on this man? And they said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. He said, I'm not going to pray on him. I'm saying, I'm going to go. A companion said, Ya Rasulullah, I will pay for him. I think it was Ukasha ibn Muhsin. He said, I'm going to pay Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet ﷺ said, are you? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet said, Ukasha, are you going to pay? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet prayed. Then Sahabi Ukasha radiallahu anhu said, the Prophet would ask me every single day, the day he got buried, did you pay? did you pay? Until I paid. When I told him, Ya Rasul, I paid. He said, Al-an, and now his body has calmed. His tranquility. All that time you didn't pay, his body wasn't, it wasn't barred. It wasn't finally tranquil. And this is debt of a human being. Dirham and dinar of a human being's money that you got on your neck. Fadaynullahi, the debt of Allah is bigger. You should know how serious it is. So it's good before another other Ramadan doesn't come to you that you pay it all back. Are you with me? And we're going to talk about the issue of the 6 days of Shawwal. Do you have to? Can you do the 6 days of Shawwal? One, if you have a debt of Ramadan on you or whatnot, we're going to talk about that, inshallah ta'ala, at the ending. Bi-idhnillah. Yeah. Yeah. So the person's got diabetes.
Or any kind of illness.
So they can't fast anymore.
And he didn't know he had to pay. Mm. And he's missing those Ramadan. I don't know how many.
Kafara.
But everything's missed.
The fast, everything has to be kafara for it.
From all those years.
All those years he has. Well, he had the illness a long time ago. So
yeah, maybe 10 years ago.
He's had a permanent illness.
Yeah.
And
he didn't know he had to pay.
If he's jahil, he's excuse for it. If he's ignorant, ignorance is excuse. He just has to pay from now onwards. No.
What if you forget how many you have to
remember? You pay from what you remember. So you say, I don't know if it was 25 or if it was 20. 20, inshallah ta'ala, you gave. Start from there.